Admin, I agree with the brother who recently confessed to your show. I'm a youth worker somewhere anonymous. We are from same town and fell victims. I was once used by this dark kingdom, using advantage of my career. He was destroyed by a word from the Bible, but he didn't tell you enough. Maybe he's still connected. There is a sentence from the Bible which was included in the prayers by people I tried to bewitch in hospitals. I was punished by the kingdom several times because of these words. These words are... Hello viewers, much enlightenment is coming. This is a confession from another ex-satanic youth worker. She is telling us about a phrase from the Bible which destroyed their kingdom. Let's listen.
I had been a nurse for several years when I first started using potions in rituals. At first it seemed easy. The rituals were simple and I thought I had control over everything. But then, something happened that I didn't expect. The first patient I tried to bewitch was an elderly woman. She was very sick and the doctors didn't think she would survive much longer. I thought it would be easy to cast the spell on her and take her soul as the cult required. I prepared everything carefully. I gathered all the ingredients I needed for the ritual and waited until late at the midnight when the hospital was quiet. I entered her room and started chanting the words I had learned from the cult. As I chanted, I was in spirit. I felt the dark energy build up around me. I was confident that the spell would work. But then something strange happened. The woman's family had been in the hospital all day, praying by her bedside. I didn't think much of it at first, but as I continued with the ritual, I felt the energy start to slip away. The prayers of the family were powerful. They were calling on Jesus to protect their loved one. It was like a shield around her. No matter how hard I tried, I couldn't break the thought that shield. The more they prayed, the weaker my spell became. In the end, I couldn't complete the ritual. The dark energy I had summoned dissipated and the woman began to recover. I was shocked. I had never felt like this before, and I couldn't understand how their prayers could have stopped me. I left the hospital right night feeling defeated and confused. I knew that the cult won't be pleased with my failure. But I also started to feel something else, a doubt growing inside me. In their prayers could stop my spells. What did that mean for the power I thought I had? In another, I attempted to kill another. After first failure, I was determined to succeed the next time. I couldn't let the cult down again. I needed to prove to myself that I still had control. The next patient was a young man, barely in his 20s. He had been in the car accident and was in coma. The doctors didn't know if he would ever wake up. This time I made sure to be more careful. I waited until his family left for the night before starting the ritual. I began chanting the spells when I was warm but in spirit at the hospital, feeling the dark energy swing around me. But just as I was about to finish, the young man's mother returned unexpectedly. She stood in the doorway, her face pale, and immediately started praying out loud, calling on Jesus to protect her son. I felt the energy that started to slip away again. Her prayers were strong, and I could feel them pushing against the dark energy I had summoned. I tried to concentrate to push through, but it was no use. Your prayers were too powerful and my spell failed. The young man started to improve after that. He didn't wake up right away, but his condition stabilizes and the doctors were hopeful for his recovery. Once again, I left the hospital feeling defeated and angry at myself for failing. I tried for the third time, fourth time and fifth time. Over the next few months, I had three more opportunities to bewitch patients. And each time I failed. The first was a middle-aged woman who had suffered a heart attack. Her family prayed constantly, by her bedside, and no matter how hard I tried, their prayers created a barrier that I couldn't break through. The second was an old man who had been in and out of the hospital for years. His family was deeply religious, and they never stopped praying for him. Even though he was weak and frail, their prayers protected him, and my spell failed again. The third was a little girl, just 5 years old. She had been diagnosed with a serious illness, and her parents were devastated. They prayed day and night for her recovery, and when I tried to cast the spell, it was like hitting a brick wall. Their faith was so strong that I couldn't even begin the ritual. After each failure, I felt the doubt inside me grow stronger. I started to question the power of the cult and the rituals I had been performing. How could these simple prayers stop the dark energy that I had once believed was so powerful? And there were people who didn't pray, and I attacked them. The first succession attempt, despite my failures, there were still times when I succeeded. The first was a person who has no family to pray for them. This person was alone in the world, and there was no one to protect them with prayers. It is said he was assistant at a sangoma before he went to the hospital. The ritual went smoothly, just as it did when I first joined the cult. There were no barriers, no shields of faith, no stop. Nothing stopped me. The dark energy flowed easily, and I was able to complete the spell. The passion passed away shortly after, and I felt a strange mix of relief. This success reminds me of the power I once believed in, but it also made me realize just how much I had come to fear the strength of prayer. I couldn't deny that there was something more powerful than dark energy I had been using. The second time I succeeded was similar to the first. The patient had no family. We were Christians. They were just people who believed in anything which can help them spiritually. They believe in sangomas again. No one pray for them and protect. The ritual was easy, almost too easy. I felt the dark energy take hold and the patient passed away without any struggle. But this time, instead of feeling powerful, I felt empty. The success didn't bring me the satisfaction it once had. Instead, it only deepened my doubts and fear. Looking back on these experiences, I can see how much they changed me. I thought I had power, but I was wrong. The strength of power, the strength of prayer, and the faith of those families was more powerful than anything I had ever encountered. Each failure chipped away at the confidence I once had in the cult's rituals. I began to question everything, my actions, the cult, and even my own beliefs. The successful rituals didn't bring me any comfort. They only made me realize how lost I had become. Now I am trying to find a way out of the darkness that I let into my life. The weight of what I have done is heavy, but I hope that by sharing my story, I can find some measures of peace.
Solution, uncle. In the name of Jesus, is considered highly powerful. Please tell your audience to use it. I would like to thank a church who helped me out of this. That faith has authority over evil. It always controlled us. The faith is often used in prayer, spiritual welfare, and healing because Christians believe it carries the authority of Jesus. Yes, it carried. I am telling from experience. That name, that faith is healing power. Tell your audience to use it. It helped me to be out of this, and I saved my child's life who was about to be sacrificed.
Thank you so much, listener, for sharing this story. We have learned from your story, but you need to repent wholeheartedly. You need to repent wholeheartedly. Don't waste God's time. Don't waste God's time, because just like the people you hate, God was also yet, so go and repent wholeheartedly. That's the first thing I would like to tell you. And if you are seeking biblical solutions to the problem you described, my brother, in your story, here are some key principles and scriptures that might offer guidance and comfort. The first important thing is repentance and forgiveness. And there's a key principle in that. The first step to overcoming any sinful past is true repentance. True repentance. In the Bible, repentance is about turning away from sin and seeking God's forgiveness with a sincere heart. There are scriptures which support that. 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Acts chapter 3, verse 19. Repent then and turn to God so that your sins may be wiped out, then that times of refreshing may come from the Lord. The power of Jesus' name. Key principle. The name of Jesus is powerful. The name of Jesus is powerful. And invoking his name in prayer can break the power of darkness. Demons and evil spirits can't stand against the authority of Jesus Christ. Philippians chapter 2, verse 9 to 11. Therefore God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God Father. Luke chapter 10, verse 17. The 72 returned with joy and said, Lord, even the demons submit to us in your name. Another thing is deliverance from evil. You need to be delivered. Key principle to that. God offers deliverance from all forms of evil, including demonic influence. Seeking deliverance through prayer, fasting, and the help of godly leaders is essential. The righteous cry out and the Lord hears them. He delivers them from all their troubles. Psalms chapter 34, verse 17. Colossians chapter 1, verse 13. For he has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son he loves. You need to renew your mind, my brother. A crucial part of moving forward in renewing your mind according to God's word. This involves rejecting the lies of the enemy and embracing the truth found in scriptures. Like if you read Romans chapter 12, verse 2, do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will is. His good and pleasing and perfect will. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 22 to 24. You were taught with regard to your former way of life to put off your old self, which is being corrupted, but its deceitful desires, to make new in the attitude of your minds, and to put on the new self created to be like God in truth. Walking in the light. Key principle. Choosing to live in the light of Christ involves leaving behind the deeds of darkness and walking in righteousness, truth, and holiness. 1 John chapter 1, verse 7. But if we walk in the light as he is the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus his Son purifies us from all sin. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 8 to 11. For you were once darkness, but now you are light in Lord. Live as children of light. You have nothing to do with the fruitless deeds of darkness, but rather expose them. Seeking God's presence. Key principle to that. Spending time in prayer, worship, and studying the Bible is vital for maintaining spiritual strength and overcoming the attacks of the enemy. James chapter 4, verse 7 to 8. Submit yourselves then to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Come near to God, and he will come near to you. Psalms chapter 91, verse 1. Whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. You also need community support and accountability. Surrounding yourself with a community of believers who can pray for you, encouraging you, and hold you accountability is crucial in overcoming spiritual battles. There are many scriptures, my brother. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 24 to 24. And let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. Galatians chapter 6, verse 2, carry each other's burdens, and in this way you fulfill the law of Christ. Trusting in God's plan. You need to trust in God's plan. Trusting in God's plan for your life and surrendering control to Him is essential. God's plan is always for your good, and He can bring redemption out of even the darkest situations. There are scriptures, Jeremiah chapter 21, verse 11, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. Romans chapter 8, verse 28, and we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love Him, who have been called according to His purpose. By applying these principles, you can find spiritual healing and deliverance from the dark forces that have influenced your life. Repentance, the power of Jesus' name, and living according to God's word are key steps in breaking free from the past and moving forward in the light of Christ. I hope you was listening. Thank you so much, listeners from around the world. Everyone was tuned in. Until we meet again in another episode. Bye for now.